Hey everybody. This guy on this catalog looks a little bit like Robert Redford back in the 70s. I don't think it is, but the catalog is 1979, and it's a Radio Shack catalog. I used to love to go to Radio Shack. They had a lot of neat things. A lot of things that I wanted, but I couldn't really afford. 1979 was kind of like the golden era. The golden times of hi-fi. So I thought maybe I would just take a look at this with you. Now, right off the bat, right on the inside cover of the catalog is Radio Shack's flagship AM/FM receiver. The brand is Realistic. That's the name that Radio Shack branded their stereo equipment, and a lot of other things too. Now back in the 70s and early 80s, there's a lot of this metal, nice metal front, you know, brushed aluminum, encased in wood. There was a lot of that, and it was a pretty good look, if you ask me. This is 120 watts per channel. And looks like there was 0.1% total harmonic distortion. That's not a bad number. But I've seen other receivers with better numbers. Now this is $600. That's pricey. That's very pricey. That's like over $3,000 in today's money. Now there's the whole system that you could get for $1,329. Now that's probably over $4,000 in today's money. So that's a pretty pricey system. Now this guy down here, he's smiling, no doubt, because he probably owns that system. Peter Nero, pianist and conductor. Yeah, he's smiling. So how do you like me now? How do you like my system? It's pretty nice. I remember going to Radio Shack. I remember this. I remember playing around with the buttons and stuff. It sounded good, especially on these particular speakers, but we'll talk more about those in a few minutes. Now for $500, which is thousands of dollars in today's money, you could get 75 watts per channel. And this one too is a nice looking receiver. Looks like it has some watt meters to tell you how much power was going to the speakers. There's a tuning meter to tell you when you have it tuned, the radio station tuned perfectly. Oh, here's another conductor looking fellow. Arthur Fiedler, Boston Pops Orchestra. Yeah, conductor of the Boston Pops Orchestra. I seriously doubt he is still with us after all these years. If you know anything about him, tell us in the comments. .55 watts per channel, 0.3 total harmonic distortion. Now you have to be careful about this. Is that 0.3 for stereo or mono? Let's take a look at these specs. Because the lower the number, the better. And it says total harmonic distortion, 0.5 stereo, 0.2% mono. I wonder where this 0.3 comes in at. Generally speaking, you don't want to be much above 0.5%. I believe my 100 watt Sherwood AM/FM receiver has 0.08, which isn't bad. And a total harmonic distortion is an important specification, but it doesn't always tell the entire story on how good a piece of audio equipment is going to sound, because there's other factors like signal to noise ratio and of course wattage. You know, sometimes the more wattage or power, the better. Now, I remember this one. It had this nice kind of a dark tinted face. And that's probably why I liked it a lot. I couldn't afford it, though. You know, I had a few items that I bought from Radio Shack, but they were never the high-end items. They were good, but they weren't this good. There's a stereo receiver with a cassette deck built in. And here's one with a black face versus a metal, a silver face. Yeah. Not too bad. Another black face. Now here's the one that I ended up buying. It's only 18 watts per channel. But that's what I could afford. And even then, that was kind of pushing it, because $260, that was like $1,000 in today's money. And that's a lot of money for just 18 watts per channel. But that's the way it was. And I really enjoyed that receiver a lot. Had it for many, many years. remember when I bought it, I was so happy to have that. When I was younger, I had a roommate. We shared an apartment. He was a good friend of mine. Somehow he ended up with my 18-watt receiver. I spoke to him a few years ago and he still had it. I kind of wish I had kept it. I think I had bought one made by Denon, and I think I may have gave this to my friend, or maybe sold it to him for a good price. I really don't remember. But he got that and the speakers. And here's 16 watts per channel. Now, I really don't like the looks of this one as much. It's okay, but this dark area, well, the look of this one is kind of dated. This is kind of how most of them looked, you know, 2 or 3 years ago. Here's one. It doesn't look that good in this picture. It's only 10 watts per channel, but it had a green dial on it. If you've been watching my channel for any length of time, you know that I like green. It's my favorite color. Here's kind of a mini system. It's an all black, got a nice green dial. I don't think it's very powerful. Let's see if we can find the output. They're not even listing it, are they? I don't really see it. Oh, there it is, right in front of me. 10 watts. Yeah, 10 watts per channel. It's very small, though. New for 70. New for 79. Here's some what they call separates. You see, a receiver like this has a amplifier and a radio tuner all in one box. So it's called a receiver. Now, separates have a separate amplifier and a separate radio tuner, so they're called separates. And these are some low cost separates. The audio quality isn't that great on these, but here's some much better quality separates. Now, these are integrated amplifiers, meaning that they have the power amp and the preamp all in one case. You can have a separate power amplifier, but then you would have to have a separate preamplifier. It's the preamplifier is what had all the buttons and stuff on it, the volume controls, things like that. The power amplifier usually just had an on-off button. But if you combine the two, as Realistic has done here, it's called an integrated amplifier. And a lot of times you could buy a matching radio tuner that was built to the same size and had a lot of the same styling cues on it, like You can see the resemblance between the amplifier and the tuner. So that's a matched set. Yep. And here is a integrated amplifier at a moderate price, 35 watts per channel. Where this one up here is 60 watts per channel. Here's the speakers. I remember going into Radio Shack and listening. I've listened to all of these back in the day. And I remember these sounded really good. Two 10-inch woofers. Nice quality speakers. But here's the big boy. Over here, 15-inch woofer. Had really, really, really low bass, all the way down to 20 hertz. It had an incredibly high range too, all the way to 25,000 hertz. The human ear that's in good condition can hear down to about 20 and up to about 20,000 hertz. And to make these really low frequencies, you gotta have some pretty large woofers. Now, I've mentioned that I couldn't afford the best items that Radio Shack sold. Here are some speakers that I did have. Even at $130 each, that was still like $700 or $800 in today's money. I mean, that's very expensive. The speakers I had before these, I built myself. I bought the drivers from Radio Shack, and I built my own cabinets. And I was pretty proud of those. But they only had 8-inch woofers, and I wanted 12-inch woofers. And I found these at Radio Shack, and they have 12-inch woofers. Frequency response wasn't as good as the speakers on the previous pages. But 45 to 20,000 is pretty respectable. On these pages are some lower priced speakers. And even lower. Here's some speaker accessories. And looks like we're getting into the turntables. Now, I never really had a great turntable until sometime in the 1980s, when I got a turntable made by a company called Dual, D-U-A-L. It was a really good turntable, but up until then I used a very inexpensive turntable, much like this one here. But back in the 70s, I was really eyeballing the ones that Radio Shack had, because they had some really nice looking turntables. I just couldn't really afford them. Now today, I no longer have a turntable. I still have records, and I kind of miss playing records, I guess. a lot of you that are listening to this video probably may not even call them records. You might just call them vinyls because they're made out of vinyl. But yeah, I do kind of miss that for nostalgic reasons, I guess. Here's the big whopping headphones that we used to wear. I had some headphones. They were made by Pioneer. I really like those. Here's a strobe light. Boy, I remember those. Still have one somewhere. Here's some kind of like disco lights that kind of flash to the beat of the music. This item up here is a power meter. It measures watts going to your speakers. So if you had an amplifier that did not have watt meters built in, you could just put this between it and your speakers and, you know, measure the wattage. Plus they're fun to look at. See the little needles bounce back and forth to the beat of the music. Here's some phonograph accessories. If you wonder what a phonograph is, that's just a record player. Now these are the all-in-one systems, and these are what a lot of us had back in like high school. I never had one quite this fancy that had a record player, AM/FM receiver, 8-track player, and it records too. And a cassette. This one has a top-loading cassette recorder all built into one. These aren't what you would call hi-fi. They're not high fidelity. I mean, they were just, you know, they were okay. But there's a world of difference in the way these sound and the ones that we've already looked at, how they sound. A world of difference. And here's some more all-in-one systems. A little bit less expensive than the previous page. So they probably sound even worse than the previous page. And they kind of get cheaper and cheaper. And here's one that looks like a little ladybug, a little record player. If you're hearing any noises, that's because I have a cat walking around out here, getting into stuff. I'm probably gonna have to kick her out of this room. I'm in my home office. As a matter of fact, this video that I'm making right now is kind of a test video for a new computer that I recently got. My other computer for my home office recently died. It was about 10 years old, so I've replaced it with a new computer that has a lot more capability to it. So I thought I would try doing this this internet-based video, and you know, with my commentary, to see if this would be a nice, relaxing video. So let me know in the comments if you do like it. Maybe we can do some more stuff like this in the future. I've tried doing these kind of videos on my laptop, but the little fan just made too much noise. So I'm hoping the quality of this video will be better. So back in high school, or a little bit before, about the 8th or 9th grade, I had a system that looked a lot like this. It was made by a different company. Oh, the cat has jumped up on this desk. She's looking for trouble. But it had an AM/FM 8-track player in it. Back during this time, you know, most of us had not really transitioned to cassettes. And this was right about the time, 1979, 1980. That's when we were kind of transitioning to cassettes for the most part. Those that could afford it probably transitioned a year or two before. Here's some portable AM/FM with 8-track. Here's a portable 8-track player. A-tracks were popular back then, especially in our cars. I had a Pontiac Trans Am that had an 8-track player in it from the factory. I had a Monte Carlo that I think had an 8-track player in it also. And I had a couple of cars that I actually put 8-track players into those cars. Oh, by the way, here's a micro cassette recorder. It used a very small form factor cassette. I have one of these. It still works. Actually, when a good friend of mine got married, I was his best man, and I actually had one of these in my coat, recording the ceremony. And I gave him the tape afterwards. And I've also used one of these in like a lecture setting, like in a classroom setting where someone was doing some lecturing, and I would just put that on the desk and record it. They used really small cassettes. Maybe you can see that right there. But yeah, I still have it. It still works. Now, when I was in middle school, I was recording. I was recording all of my music on a cassette player, much like this. And back then, you know, cassettes weren't really being used in hi-fi systems, but they were around in devices much like this. I used to just plug a microphone into it and then hold it in front of the speaker of a radio and record music like that. Here's some portable cassette recorders. They were still kind of chunky. And, you know, back then you didn't really, you know, they still had speakers, okay? But when Sony released the Walkman, a little miniature cassette player, it played regular sized cassettes. Well, all of a sudden, you know, those did not have speakers in them. So people wore headphones. And then all of a sudden, you know, no one was really talking to each other. Before then, you know, we had radios and stuff, but they had speakers on them. So you were still talking to people. But as soon as you stuck those headphones in your ears or over your ears, then everybody shuts up. And interaction between people just starts disappearing. Now, I mentioned that during these years, you know, 8-tracks and cassettes were still being used. And I had this particular 8-track recording deck. Yeah, it's a TR-802. I really enjoyed it. You know, I bought blank 8-track tapes, and then I just recorded the music from mainly the radio. Just, you know, when a song would come on, I would have the thing all ready to go. And when a song came on, I just had to push a button and start recording it. And I was hoping the DJ would, you know, let the song play all the way through before he started talking again. And if, in, you know, that unit recorded, now here's one that is just for playback. It doesn't record. Because you could buy 8-track tapes that already had music on them. And as I mentioned, the cassette decks were starting to become pretty popular. And Radio Shack had some nice ones. Especially this one right here. It's not quite as nice as the one that I have currently, that I still listen to. But it is nice, and it's expensive. At $380, this would be well over $1,000 in today's money. Here's the blank cassette tapes and the blank 8-track tapes that we used to buy. I still have some of these super tapes that are still, you know, they're still unopened. They're still in the cellophane. Same thing with this more economical blank 8-track tape. I still have some of these. Oh, and here's another one of those miniature mini cassettes. Here's blank tapes for reel-to-reel tape recorders. Here's some tape recorder accessories. More tape recorder accessories. And carrying cases to protect your 8-track and cassettes. Radio Shack carried microphones also. Here's some public address, you know, PA systems. And more PA stuff. Here's wireless intercom system. Just plug in and talk. And here's some telephone stuff. Different styles of telephones. you know, back in 1979, you know, we still had rotary phones. You know, you put your finger in it and just, you know, move the dial. And a lot of times, if you had a telephone, you might have an answering machine also. And a lot of these answering machines use cassette tapes. You had one cassette tape was to play your message, and another cassette tape would record the message that the caller left. Eventually, they went to electronic based. You didn't have to have tapes. Here's some underdash 8-track players and cassette. 8-track here, cassette here. These are called underdash because you would mount them under the dashboard of your car. And here's some in-dash. You would mount these AM/FM cassette players in the dashboard, not under it, but in the dashboard. Yeah, here's a picture right here. Mount in-dash, or you could also mount them under-dash. And here's some amplifiers that you could add to your sound system inside your car. What we were using back then was pretty neat back then. It's nothing compared to what people put in their cars today, though. So, but we were pretty happy with it back then. Some of the cars back then had AM radios, and if you wanted to get FM, you might have to buy a device like this. You would mount this under the dash, and it would allow you to receive FM signals. Speakers, these are called triaxle speakers. You had three speaker cones in one unit, a woofer, mid-range, and a tweeter. So those were pretty popular. I had some of those in some of my cars. And here's some more. Here's a FM booster to amplify your FM signal to make it better. And here's a really small FM converter. So if your car didn't have FM, you could add FM by installing this. Auto accessories. And speakers. You know, drivers. When I made my first set of stereo speakers, I bought the drivers from Radio Shack. I bought these tweeters. These are 1-inch dome type tweeters. They were like $11 each. And I bought these woofers. These are 8-inch woofers. And they were $17 each. And then you had to have a way to send the high frequencies to the tweeters and the low frequencies to the woofers. And that's what you used these crossovers for. So if you had a woofer and a tweeter, you would use a two-way crossover. But if you had a woofer and a tweeter and a mid-range, well, then you needed a three-way. And here's some replacement speakers. And here's the famous Radio Shack TRS-80 computer. In the 80s, my first computer that I owned was a Radio Shack computer, a Tandy. I believe it was a TRS-80, except it was a color computer. All of these didn't have color. Here's the store directory. There's Radio Shacks were just everywhere. And now, so many have closed down. I don't know if any are still open. Maybe, I don't know. If you know, tell me in the comments. Now, if you were into electronics, as in projects, electronic projects where you made things, Radio Shack was the place to get all of your parts, all of your components. You know, resistors and diodes and transistors and you know, integrated circuits, chips. And empty metal boxes to put your projects, you know, mount your projects inside of these. There's some power supplies. I had that 12-volt supply. And multi-testers, you know, measure resistance and voltage and amperage. And there's a radar detector. You know, radar detectors in the 70s were kind of new. And everybody wanted one. And there's a security system type stuff. A metal detector. Outdoor, indoor thermometer. Vacuum tubes. There's a brazing torch, a little miniature brazing torch. I had one of those. It was pretty neat. Lots of tools and stuff like that for the electronics hobbyist. Batteries, calculators. By 1979, the price had came down a little bit on calculators. In the mid-70s, they were really expensive. My first calculator was a Texas Instruments TI-30. The TI-30 was a model number that Texas Instruments used for probably a couple of decades or more. But the early models looked like this, to tell you the truth. I can tell by the case in the little red LED readout that this calculator was probably made by Texas Instruments, because it looks a lot like my TI-30 that you've probably seen in one or two of my videos, because I still have my first calculator. And it still works. Electronic learning project kits. It's a great way to learn about electronics. And here's some kits that you can build yourself. Strobe light, disco light. Here's some toys, walkie-talkies, and little primitive radio control cars. TV antennas. TV antennas and accessories. More TV antenna stuff. Here is a programmable scanner, like a police scanner. Looks like this one could be, it could scan up to 16 channels at once. Now that's quite low by today's standards, because my scanners can scan hundreds of channels at one time. But back then you could just scan just a few. These handhelds can only scan 4. My handheld can scan 200 at a time. Here's some walkie-talkies. I really liked walkie-talkies when I was a kid. And here's some CB accessories. CB radio. CB stands for citizen band. That's what us citizens could use. Here's CB antennas. And CBs, that was before cell phones. So if you were in your car and you wanted to talk to someone outside of your car, they also had to have a CB radio inside their car. And then you were limited by range. These were okay for just, 3 or 4 miles. But beyond that, they faded off kind of quickly. But they were very, very popular back in the 70s. Very popular. And then, cell phones came along in the late 80s and 90s. CBs kind of disappeared. Unless you are relaxing ASMR, and then you still have one in your truck, like I do.